Hi, and welcome to this Jumpcast about testing in Ruby. In this video, we're going to look at test-driven development, or TDD for short. This is the process of writing your tests first and then creating the code so that the tests pass later. We're going to write some specs using Minitest, which is a lightweight testing suite that has been included in the standard Ruby library since version 1.9. After we've written the tests, we're going to write some code and try to get all the tests to pass. The app that we're going to build is based on Fizzbuzz. Now, if you haven't come across Fizzbuzz before, it's a way of counting where multiples of 3 are replaced by fizz and multiples of 5 are replaced by buzz, as you can see here. We're going to implement this by creating a Fizzbuzz class that has a method called print, as we can see here. An integer is entered as an argument and a string is returned corresponding to what it would be in Fizzbuzz. So the integer 15 would become Fizzbuzz, because it's a multiple of 3 and 5. So as you can see, the variable fb is holding an instance of the Fizzbuzz class, and we can use this to see how the print method works. So we can do fb.print3, and it displays fizz, because that's a multiple of 3. If we do fb.print5, we get buzz. And let's try 15. And we get Fizzbuzz, because it's a multiple of both. Now, if we try a number that's not a multiple of 3 or 5, such as 13, we just get that number returned as a string. Another cool thing we can do is enter a range of values. So, for example, I can enter print 1 to 15, and it will return an array of all the different Fizzbuzz values. So that's how the class should work in the end. Let's take a few steps back now and look at writing the tests to describe that behaviour. We need two files. So I've got this folder here called Fizzbuzz. If I open it up, we can see the two files, one for the code, which I've called fizzbuzz.rb, and one for the specs, which I've called spec.rb. Since we're using test-driven development, we'll start with the tests. So if I open this up, we can see our test file here. At the start of a test file, we need to require minitest/autorun. We also need to require the file that contains our code. Although it's empty at the moment, we still need to require it to start with. I've used require relative here, and the name of the file Fizzbuzz, and this works just like the normal require, but instead of using Ruby's load path, it loads from a path relative to the file itself. Now, since both of these files are in the same folder, then I simply need to pass the file name as an argument, as you can see here. The nice thing about specs is that they read very much like English. Specs contain descriptions of behaviour that we require. Now, since this is only a small class, we only have one description here, called Fizzbuzz. But for bigger applications, you can write lots of different descriptions for different parts of the application. Now, a description starts with a before block that you can see here. This is run before all of the specs, so we use it to set up anything that we need to use in the specs. In this case, we want to set up an instance method called fb here. And this is just a new instance of the Fizzbuzz class that we're going to create later. And we also have an instance method called number. Now, this is a randomly generated number that's definitely not a multiple of 15. I do this by multiplying a random number from between 1 to 100 by 15, which will make it definitely a multiple of 15, and then adding 1, which will guarantee that 3, 5, and 15 are not divisors of this number. Next, we write the actual tests. Minitest uses a variety of methods that use the words must and won't to describe the expected behaviour that we want. Now, each spec is written inside an it block that describes what is being tested. You can see an example here in our first test. We simply write the keyword it, followed by a description of the behaviour we expect. So the first behaviour I want to test is that we return fizz for multiples of 3. And this is followed by a block, which starts with do and ends with the keyword end. And inside this, we use the method must equal. As I mentioned earlier, all the methods are either must or won't. We'll see an example of won't later. So what we're saying here is, if we use the print method with our FB instance variable, which remember is an instance of our Fizzbuzz class, and we use a number that's a multiple of 3, I've created that by multiplying our number instance variable by 3 to guarantee that it is a multiple of 3, then this must equal fizz. So the return value of this method must be fizz. Most of the tests are written in a similar way. So we can see the next test is that it returns buzz for multiples of 5. And this is very similar, except the argument I use for the print method is 5 times the number, which will guarantee that it's a multiple of 5. And we use the must equal method again and say it must be equal to the string buzz. And in a similar way, my next test is testing to see that we return fizzbuzz for multiples of 15. And we just multiply by 15, the number, to guarantee we have a multiple of 15. And we say that must equal the string fizzbuzz. Our next test is a test to say that it returns the number as a string for all non-Fizzbuzz numbers. So anything that's not a multiple of 3, 5 or 15. Now remember, we guaranteed that this instance variable number was not a multiple of 15. So therefore, 3, 5 and 15 both won't divide into that number. And this time it must equal the number itself as a string. So we use the toString method to test that these two things are the same. The return value of the print method is giving the number as a string. Our next test is using one of the won't methods. And we don't technically need this test because we've already tested everything. We've tested this really above. But this is just an example of how you could use one of the won't methods. And this is to say, it doesn't say fizzbuzz when it shouldn't do. So here, when we have a number that's not a multiple of 15, remember that number definitely isn't, then we say it won't equal fizzbuzz. Now we have actually in the test right above just tested that this equals the number as a string. So like I said, technically we don't actually need to test that, but it's useful just to demonstrate how to use won't. In fact, there is generally a won't equivalent for all of the must methods. So we have must equal and also won't equal. And we'll see some more examples of the must methods now. The next thing is we want it to return an array object when we give a range as an argument. And this is a good example of another must method here, the must be an instance of. And here we're saying that the return value when we enter a range as an argument into the print method must be an array. And this here can be any type of Ruby object. In this case, it's an array that we want returned, so we're just testing that an array comes back. And the last three tests are all about some error testing that I want to do, so we just want to handle a few different errors that could happen. Fizzbuzz is only really for integers, so we want it to raise an error if the number is negative. So when we use this method, this is the must raise method. Again, there's a won't raise equivalent as well. And we put the print method here with a negative argument. And we're saying that this needs to raise an error and actually defining it as an argument error that needs to be raised. We've got a few more errors that I want to be raised here. So the next one is that if we enter 0, we want it to also raise an error. And this is very similar. We use a proc and We put 0 as the argument into the print method, and we say this must raise an argument error again. And one last error we want to test for is that if we don't use integers in the argument. So we're saying again, it must raise an error if it's not an integer. So we use a proc again with the print method with an argument of 2.5, so clearly not an integer, and this must raise an argument error. So they're all our tests. That's what we expect from our application. So the first thing we do is actually run this spec file and see what happens. So if I go back into my console here and exit from IRB, now I'm in the folder path where my files are saved, and spec.rb is just a Ruby file. So we run it by simply entering Ruby spec.rb. And once I press enter, it will run the tests, and we can see the output at the bottom. There were 9 tests that we wrote, and it's actually returned 9 errors. You can actually go back and check on these errors, but they're quite verbose in this case, and generally this is because we don't actually have any code. If we go and have a look at our fizzbuzz.rb file here, it's completely empty, so no wonder it's giving us all those errors. So let's have a go at putting together the Fizzbuzz class. This is my first attempt here. Just save that. Just quickly run through this. I have the print method here, and we basically run through the tests to see if the number is a multiple of 15. So I'm doing this using this modulo arithmetic operator here, which basically tests the remainder when you divide by 15. Now, if the number is a multiple of 15, then the remainder will be 0. So this means that if we get 0, it's a multiple of 15, so we want to return Fizzbuzz. Else, if it's a number of, if it's a multiple of 3, then we return Fizz. And if it's a multiple of 5, we return Buzz. Otherwise, we just want to return the number converted to a string. So let's run our tests again and see how we do. If we go back into the terminal and type in Ruby spec.rb, we can see now that we've run 9 tests, 8 assertions, but we've got 3 failures and 1 error. So if we just go back and have a look at these here, the first failure was it raises an error if the number is 0. It didn't raise an error if the number was 0. That we haven't really got any error handling in here, so we'll have a look at that soon. Here we've got an error. The test was it returns an array object when a range is given as an argument, as you can see here. So that's not working. We haven't implemented that yet. This is because there's no method. The percent sign, the modulo operator, doesn't exist for a range, so that resulted in error. So we need to go ahead and fix that. And the other 2 failures were the errors being raised. So like I say, we haven't got any error handling. So let's fix the error first with the range. Let's try and deal with that. So if we go back to our Fizzbuzz file, and I think we need another method here. So I'm going to change the print method to this method here. And what I want to do now is just check if the argument responds to the each method. So that's basically, is it an array or is it a range? And if so, then I want to iterate over each number in that range or array and use a method called test, which is actually going to be my old print method. So I'm going to update that down here to be called test now. And I only want this to be accessible from within this class, so I'm going to actually make it a private method as well. So this print method here will have access to this method called test. And here we say, so if the argument entered responds to each, then we'll iterate through each value and we'll run this test on it and send back the output. Otherwise, then we'll just run the method test on it, just like we did before. So this should have the functionality for testing ranges of numbers. So let's save that and go back and run our tests. Again, Ruby, spec.rb in the terminal. And now we can see that all 9 tests and assertions have been run. We have no errors, which is good, but we've still got 3 failures. And if I just look back now, we can see, you can see as it says running the tests here, you've got that each dot is a test being passed. Then we've got fail, fail, fail. And each one is to do with our error handling. So it seems that 0 are negative numbers and non-integer values can still be entered. So that's our next thing to fix. Let's go back to my Fizzbuzz file. And I just really need to deal with this in the test method here. And by really adding these 2 lines here, that raises an argument error unless the number is greater than 0. So this should deal with numbers that are 0 or below, so negative numbers or 0. That should deal with 2 of our tests. And this line here raises an error and gives the feedback integers only unless the number is an integer. And I'm using the isA method there to test whether the argument entered is in fact an integer. So that should raise the errors that we want, so give some feedback to people about the arguments they're entering and why it's raising an error. And if I just save that now and run the tests, Ruby spec.rb and press enter, we can see that it was running the tests and all these dots indicate that all the tests have passed. As we can see by the summary here, we've got 9 tests, 9 assertions, and no failures and no errors. That's great. We now have some functioning code. And what we've done is we've started off with our tests, written our tests, and described using specs what we want to happen, the behavior, what we want in our code. And then we've gone ahead and written our code, and we saw it went in phases. We had a few errors and failures to start with, but we gradually added to the code, and eventually each test passed. I hope you found that useful, and make sure whenever you're writing your Ruby code from now on, you write the tests first and then write the code. Thanks for listening.